Good morning, students. So we are passing through the chapter. It is excretion. So in the previous session, we discussed about this, the structure of this excretory system, human excretory system, which includes pair of kidney, pair of ureter, urinary bladder, as well as urethra, right? And we discussed about this major excretory organ. It is kidney. So we discussed about the structure of the kidney. And the structural and functional unit of the kidney is known as nephron. So we discuss about the structure of this nephron also, right? And in this session, we are going to discuss about one of the very important question, that is the mechanism of urine formation, right? So what is the role of excretory system? So that the previous first class even we have discussed, the excretory system is helping to eliminate this toxic substances from the body in the form of urine, right? So the substances which is not necessary to the body or which is toxic to the body should be eliminated. So as we said already, so during protein metabolism, a protein is made up of amino acid and amino acid go for this metabolic process. So during this metabolic process of this amino acid, nitrogenous waste will be released. Okay, so the nitrogenous waste is in the three forms, ammonia, urea and uric acid, right? So in the human being, this nitrogenous waste is will be in the form of urea, right? So this urea is toxic to the body, it should be eliminated, right? So this urea along with the water, it forms urine. So this urine is collected in this excretory system with the help of this nephron and it will be eliminated, right? So that is the process of this mechanism of urine formation. In this session, we are going to discuss how this urine is formed from the blood. Actually, blood only they are circulating throughout the body. The blood consists of this urea and this some other substances which should be eliminated from the body, right? So how this urine is formed from the kidneys and how it is eliminated. So that mechanism only today we are supposed to discuss. Understand? Mechanism of urine formation. So today we are supposed to discuss this major topic. It is mechanism of urine formation. It is one of this very important topic, right? So this mechanism, actually it is overall, it is going to, you know, release this urine. The kidney is going to, you know, form this urine, not urea. Actually, the urea is synthesized in the liver. Urea is synthesized in the liver cells, and this urea is transported to the nephron in the kidney. Nephron will collect this urea in the form of this urine, and it will eliminate from the body. Right? So, urea is formed in the liver and it is eliminated by the kidney. So don't confuse. Urea is formed in the liver cells. Liver. And it will be eliminated by the kidney. Have you got? Okay. And let us discuss about this mechanism of urine formation. Okay. So this overall process, it is a little complicated process. And this overall process, they divided into three, you know, divisions or three phases. Right. So let us see about the three phases first of all. So hope before we go for these processes or the phases which involve in this urine formation, just we can give one outlook about the structure of this nephron, then it will be easy to collect the points, right? So in the previous class, we have discussed about the structure of the nephron. So there is, you know, the first major part of this nephron is this, you know, Malpighian body. Okay, or we could say it is the Malpighian body includes glomerulus. It is a capillary, blood capillary, and which is covered with this Bowman's capsule. So this glomerulus and the Bowman's capsule together we could say as a Malpighian body, right? So it, this is one of the very important region here. So in the glomerulus or in the nephron, so each kidney consists of millions of nephrons, right? So one arteriole, So one arteriole that is known as afferent arteriole, which is going inside this glomerulus, right? And it is supplying the blood into this glomerulus. Okay. And the next arteriole, both these arteriole only, is coming away from this glomerulus, is known as efferent arteriole. So afferent arteriole as well as efferent arteriole. So this efferent arteriole is collecting the blood from here and it is coming away. Right? Okay. So this is a setup of this Bowman's capsule now, right? And then it is leading to the long tubule, and this tubule is divided as 1, 2, 3, 4 sections, right? So the first part of this coiled tube is known as proximal convoluted tubule. So shortly we could write as PCT. Then loop of Henle. The long U-shaped tube is known as loop of Henle. So this is the descending limb and this next part ascending limb. This is thin and this is thick. Okay. And then the next coiled tube is known as distal convoluted tubule. DCT, distal convoluted tubule. It is leading into the last tubule that is known as collecting duct. So in the collecting duct, not only one nephron, many nephrons fuse together in this collecting duct. That's why it is marked. Okay, so one nephron is joined here. Like this, many nephron will form in this, you know, in this collecting duct, and it will form as a papillary duct finally. Right? Okay. Then one more thing we have to say, that is, so this afferent arteriole is this arteriole which is coming away from this Bowman's capsule, and it will surround this proximal convoluted tubule as well as this distal convoluted tubule. Okay, so that also, that tubule is known as peritubular capillaries. Peritubular capillaries. Okay, so in the previous session also we discussed about it. Peritubular capillaries. And the tubules which is surrounding this loop of Henle is known as vasa recta. Okay, so now this is this, you know, structure of this nephron. This is going to involve in this urine formation function. Okay. So first of all, you have to know one thing. So during the protein metabolism, actually urea will be produced, and this toxic substances which is present in the body also has to be eliminated from the body, right? So kidney is doing the major role to collect this, you know, urea, to collect the urea, not to produce the urea. It is collecting the urea through the nephrons. Okay, and so from the blood, this urea will be collected and it will be sent as a urine now. Okay, so this overall process only we are going to discuss now, right? So this process is going on by 3 steps. So the first one is glomerular ultrafiltration, or glomerular filtration also we can say, glomerular filtration. The second step is tubular reabsorption. Tubular reabsorption. And the third step is tubular secretion. Tubular secretion. Now let us see what happens here. Right. Okay, listen. The first process is glomerular ultrafiltration. Okay. So this is going on inside this glomerulus and the Bowman's capsule. This process takes place. Okay. So as we said, this afferent arteriole is bringing the blood to this glomerulus now. Glomerulus is this capillary bed. It is this ball of capillary bed. Okay. So this afferent arteriole, listen, afferent arteriole is bringing the blood to this glomerulus, right? So in the glomerulus, when it brings, this blood consists of all the substances which is present in the blood. So whatever is necessary to the body, and whatever is should be eliminated from the body, everything is present in this blood. Okay. So that's why the blood is coming here to the glomerulus now, to the Bowman's capsule. The Bowman's capsule consists of the glomerulus. So it is coming towards the glomerulus, right? And from here, the blood will be filtered. Filtered. Do you understand what is filtration? When we filter, some substances will be here and some substances will be filtrated through the sieve. You know, when we prepare the tea, we know how it will be filtered, right? The tea will settle on the sieve and this you know, the filtrate come below the sieves, right? The same way. So now the blood is coming. Blood is coming to this glomerulus. So this consists of all the substances, and when it comes to the glomerulus, this glomerulus function like a filtrator. So filtrates, what it will filtrate when the blood comes here, except the blood cells, notice this, except the blood cells and this mainly the protein, plasma protein, the plasma consists of protein, right? And the plasma consists of blood cells also. So except the blood cells and except this plasma protein, right? So all other substances will be filtered through this glomerulus. It is a capillary bed and it consists of these holes here, minute holes, and this particles which is more than 5 nanometer in size cannot be transferred from here, right? So cannot be. So the macromolecules, the biggest molecules, RBC cells and this, you know, plasma protein, everything will not be filtered. So this will be left here. Understand? So that is collected by afferent arteriole. Okay? That is collected by afferent arteriole. Then what is the role of this afferent arteriole? We'll come at last. Okay? So now it is, the blood came to this glomerulus and it is filtered, right? So after the filtration, the filtrate formed by this glomerulus. So this fluid is formed here, right? Now the filtrate which is formed in this Bowman's capsule, from here to here it transfer through the basement membrane. So it will transfer here, right? So now the filtrate which is formed here is known as glomerular filtrate. Dig it? It is known as glomerular filtrate. Have we got? So afferent arteriole is bringing the blood. The blood consists of all the substances. So the first process is glomerular filtration. So this glomerulus behave function like a filtrate. So when it filtrate, every substances whatever is present in the blood will be filtrated. And the filtrate formed by this method is collected in this Bowman's capsule, and hence this is known as a glomerular filtrate. So except blood cells and the plasma protein and the macromolecules which is present here will be collected by the efferent arteriole. Is it clear? Okay. So for this filtration process, for one filtration is going on, right? To do this one filtration process, we need one pressure. Unless there is a pressure, this material will not be filtered, right? So it need one pressure. So let us see what are the pressure is applied here to produce this filtrate, right? So the blood which comes from this afferent arteriole has the pressure that is known as this glomerular hydrostatic pressure. That is known as this glomerular hydrostatic pressure. So glomerular hydrostatic pressure. So pressure which is mentioned here, right? So that is 55 mmHg. 55 mmHg, right? There is a unit. So its a pressure level is now 55 mmHg, you can say, right? And then, so this is the forward pressure now. It's a forced pressure. Plus, against this, the opposite pressure is created from here. Understand? So opposite pressure is created from here. That is no, that is two opposite pressure will be created from here. One is a colloidal osmotic pressure. Colloidal osmotic pressure. So which means, so the plasma which is present already here. Understand? So the plasma which is present already here will produce one pressure. That is known as a colloidal osmotic pressure. That is 30 mmHg. So that is 30 mmHg. Okay. The second pressure, opposite pressure, is capsular hydrostatic pressure. So the filtrate which is formed here will produce one opposite pressure here. That is known as capsular hydrostatic pressure, that is 15 mmHg. Have you got? Okay, so now, so the forward pressure is 55 mmHg. So the opposite pressure overall, we could say 30 mmHg plus 15 mmHg, it is 45 mmHg. Am I right? Okay, so then if we calculate how much pressure is used here to get this filtrate, so how can we calculate this? Net filtrate pressure equal to 55 mmHg or glomerular hydrostatic pressure minus the opposite pressure. What do you mean opposite pressure? It is a combination of colloidal osmotic pressure as well as the capsular hydrostatic pressure. So 30 mmHg plus 15 mmHg, overall 45 mmHg. So 55 mmHg minus this 45 mmHg is equal to 10 mmHg. So this 10 mmHg is used to get this glomerular filtrate. Have you got? So net filtrate pressure is totally 10 mmHg. Okay, then not only this pressure level, then one more reason also there to get this filtrate here. Can you watch? This afferent arteriole is wider and this efferent arteriole is narrow. So here this blood will be sent with a heavy force because it is very wider tubule. But here since it is coming very faster than this efferent arteriole, because in the efferent arteriole it is moving very slowly only since it is narrow tube. So the pressure will be created, increased here. That also another one reason for the formation of this glomerular filtrate. Okay, then now let us see how much glomerular filtrate will be produced. So that is known as glomerular filtrate rate. Glomerular filtrate rate. So shortly we could say GFR, glomerular filtrate rate. Okay. So the volume of the filtrate formed per minute. So here, this is one nephron, right? I said there is a millions of nephron is present in each kidney. Okay. So here, what do you mean glomerular filtrate rate? The volume of filtrate formed per minute. The glomerular filtrate formed per minute from all the nephrons from both the kidneys. Do you understand? The filtrate formed by all the nephrons. So millions of nephrons we could say from both the kidneys. So the glomerular filtrate formed by both the kidneys overall we could say per minute is known as glomerular filtrate rate. The volume of the filtrate formed per minute. So for normal adult it is 125 ml per minute. 125 ml per minute. So in such a case per day it is 170 to 180 liter. Can you imagine? 170 to 180 liters of this glomerular filtrate is formed by both the kidneys per day. But we are not releasing 170 to 180 liters of urine per day. Understand? So only glomerular filtrate is formed. So now the filtrate is almost, actually it is isotonic, they said. So here I mentioned it is isotonic. What do you mean isotonic? Almost similar. The similar only, same only we say it is isotonic. So this blood only came here. So after the filtration, the glomerular filtrate is formed here. So now the fluid is known as glomerular filtrate. This is almost same like a blood, right? But except what are the things? Blood cells as well as this protein, plasma protein. So that's why they mentioned it here, isotonic, almost the same, right? So now the thing is, now the first process glomerular filtrate is over. But from the two kidneys per day, 170 to 180 liters of glomerular filtrate is formed. But we are not releasing this 170 to 180 liters of this urine per day, right? So moreover, we could say it is approximately 1.5 liters of this urine will be released per day from one normal adult. And what about this rest of this glomerular filtrate? What happened this one? And how this 1.5 liter is formed finally? So that is the next process we could say, it is tubular reabsorption. Reabsorption. So this Bowman's capsule is continued as a long tubule, we say, right? So in this tubule only going to do the next process, it is tubular reabsorption. Okay, so what happens here, you know, so in during this process, actually this glomerular filtrate consists of all the substances, the substances which is necessary to the body and the substances which is not necessary to the body. For example, we could say it consists of lot of water and glucose, amino acid, right, and urea also, so uric acid, so those things will be there. So the substances which is necessary to the body, we could say it is high threshold substances. So those substances will be reabsorbed from these tubules by the surrounding tissue. So these tubules will reabsorb. Okay, why they say it is a reabsorption? No, once already when we discuss about the digestion, we talk about this absorption. So there, after the digestion of the food materials, this in the small intestine, the villi will absorb the nutrients, right? So afterwards, once again it is absorbed by this nephron. That's why they said it is reabsorption. Okay, so throughout this tubule, the process is simple. Throughout this tubule, now this 180, around 170 liters, or around 180, one, you know, 170 to 180 liters of this water and the substances will be reabsorbed, which means this is sending the substances again to the body. Okay, so through these tubules, it is sending the substances again to the body because it is highly necessary to the body, right? And only the waste along with the little water, it will be eliminated. And that process, we can see how it happens. Under the second phase, it is tubular reabsorption. Have we got? So first, when it passes here in the tubule, the first tubule is proximal convoluted tubule, right? So here, as I said already, this fluid which comes in this tubule is now isotonic in nature, which means it is almost, this concentration is almost like a plasma, blood now. So that's why they said it's isotonic in nature, right? And especially from this tubule, they say, and the proximal convoluted tubule, the substances such as, you know, glucose, lactate, amino acid, sodium, and water. So in this filtrate, so these are all already present in the filtrate, but it is highly necessary to the body. That's the word we could say, the high threshold substances, it is needed to the body. So those substances will be sent, it is reabsorbed in this proximal convoluted tubule by, you know, active transport method also there, passive transport method is there, you know, and a diffusion method is there, osmosis method is there, to transfer from the higher concentration to the lower concentration. And especially we can say it is, and it is absorbed by this active process. So sodium and the potassium ion, from here it will be absorbed by active process. What do you mean active process? It's an energy needed process, right? From lower concentration to higher concentration, it is known as active process. And from here, little amount of urea as well as uric acid also will be, little, very little amount of urea as well as uric acid also will be absorbed. Okay. Now, after some reabsorption, some substances is reabsorbed from here, right? Then the next, this fluid or the filtrate is moving towards this, the loop of Henle, the long tubule, U-shaped tubule is known as loop of Henle. So, this consists of the two regions. One is descending limb, another one is ascending limb. So when it comes to the descending limb, especially this is highly permeable for water. So this is highly permeable for water. So fully water will be, you know, sent out, because this wall consists of the pore that is known as aquaporins. Aquaporins will be there. So through the pore, this water will be eliminated out. Water will be eliminated out, but it is not allowing the other solutes, other substances. Only water is permitted. Okay, so listen, if this water is permitted, and it don't allow this salt substances. So just imagine if we remove the water from this this filtrate, what happens here? The sodium and the potassium chlorine ions concentration may increase. So it become as is a concentration fluid now. Do you get me? Since water is removed, the solution may become as a concentrated solution. So actually from here it is coming as an isotonic, but from this descending to the ascending limb, when it move, it becomes as hypertonic, right? So why it is hyper? Because the concentration is increased. If the concentration is low, we can say it's a hypotonic. So now it became as a hypertonic because the water came out from here. Okay. And the next process, now the hypertonic fluid is coming to the next tubule, that is ascending limb. So in the ascending limb, what happens? It will not permit the water, just opposite. It will not permit the water, but will permit this, salt and other substances. So sodium, chlorine, potassium will be permeable from here. So water is not permeable. So here, since this, ions and the salt content is removed from here, once again, now that's why the hypertonic is becoming as a hypotonic. Do you get me? So water is there, but this solute is removed. So we can say it is becoming as an isotonic fluid, right? So now this isotonic fluid is passed to this next tubule, that is distal convoluted tubule. So in the distal convoluted tubule, this is one of this specific region we can say, as per this need of this body, and the substances will be reabsorbed from here. If this body need this substances, for example potassium or sodium or bicarbonates, it will be reabsorbed from here. Understand? So the sodium and the chlorine or this bicarbonate ions may reabsorb from these places and as per the necessary of this body. Okay. And then finally it is coming towards the collecting duct. So collecting duct, actually it is highly permeable to water. So large amount of this water will be eliminated or from reabsorbed from the collecting tubule. So since the large amount of water is released from here, so the substances or the filtrate which is present inside will become more and more hypertonic. The concentration become very high. So we can say it will become as hypertonic. So listen. So per day, in like this process, per day from all the nephrons, from both the kidneys, as we said, around, if we consider is 170 liters of this glomerular filtrate is formed, 168.5 glomerular filtrate is 170, right? But we said only around 1.5 liters of this urine only will be produced. This is glomerular filtrate. This is urine. Urine is 1.5. So rest 168.5. 168.5 liters of this glomerular filtrate is reabsorbed by these tubules per day. Understand? And finally, just 1.5 liters of concentrated urea plus other substances which should be eliminated from the body along with this water, it will be eliminated in the form of this urine. So this all, many collecting duct form together and it will become as a papillary duct. The papillary duct open in the calyx. Calyx open into the pelvis. Pelvis open into this ureter. Ureter open into the urinary bladder. Urinary bladder open as this urethra. Then it will be eliminated. That is a path. Okay. And then this tubular reabsorption also over. Almost the process is over. No? Then why they mentioned this third process is tubular secretion. So third one phase process is that there is tubular secretion. So what happens here is, as I said already, this efferent arteriole is coming out of this glomerulus, is collecting the substances which is not filtrated here. Am I right? So the rest of the substances will be collected from here. Understand? And that also consists of some ions. Especially sodium, hydrogen ion, potassium ion, ammonia and urea. salts. So those substances is the present again here, right? So as I said already, this afferent arteriole, which is surrounding this proximal as well as this distal, this tubule is known as peritubular capillaries. And which is surrounding this Henle loop is known as vasa recta. Okay, so what is the role here, listen? When it surrounds this proximal as well as the distal convoluted tubule, so this proximal and the distal convoluted tubule will, reabsorb these substances from this tubule, and again it will take it along with this, this filtrate. Do you understand? Actually, these substances is not coming through this path. This is coming through this path. Do you get me? The substances, hydrogen ion and the ammonia, those things is not coming through this filtration. Because it is the biggest particles, it can, will not be filtered by here, right? So that's why it is coming through this efferent arteriole. So from the efferent arteriole, since it is surrounding here, these tubules will reabsorb these substances from here. Understand? So that's why, so this is not actually present in this glomerular filtrate, but it is present in these tubules. That's why they say it is known as tubular secretion. Understand? So once, and here they say, for when one hydrogen ion comes inside, one sodium ion will be absorbed by the tubular cells. From here, when one hydrogen ion comes inside, then one sodium ion will be reabsorbed, right? So this hydrogen ion will combine with this HCO3, HPO3 and NH3. Then it will produce this H2CO4, H2PO4 and NH4. So that's why this hydrogen ion concentration will be maintained here. Understand? And so that's all about this mechanism of urine formation. So this tubular secretion is nothing else. So this is the special substances which is collected from this tubule, since it is known as a tubular secretion. Is it clear? So the mechanism of urine formation is going on with three steps: glomerular ultrafiltration, right? Then tubular reabsorption and tubular secretion. Understand? So then finally the concentrated urine will be eliminated through this urethra. Is it clear? So hope you have understood, and please read this textbook also very well, and learn the chapter, and hope you are following, and we can meet in the next class. Thank you.